been held by a Savior. I've felt fire from above. I've been down to the river. I ain't the same, a prodigal return.
Everyone, and welcome to worship from wherever you are. As we begin, I want to share with you a blessing that we have had as a congregation over the last several of years. We have had the opportunity to support two students as they answered the call to seminary studies. Gary Rebuck is finishing his Master of Divinity degree from Regent University in just this next month. And Lori Parsons will finish in this year her Master in Christian Leadership from Gordon-Conwell Seminary. It has been our privilege and blessing to support them financially, to support them with our prayers, with our encouragement, and by providing for them opportunities to put into practice the things that they are learning in the classroom. Gary and his wife Patty have been on this journey for 10 years. Gary works full-time at OSI, Occupational Services, And in addition, he, for the last 10 years, he has come home from work in the evenings and in the weekends. He has completed his bachelor's degree at Liberty University. And as I said, in just this next month, he will finish his Master of Divinity degree from Regent University. I mention these two because I encourage you to pray along with us for them, that they can finish this semester well and Gary can finish his whole degree program well. He's been in an internship with us this last semester, trying to fit in 200 hours in addition to working full time and just being a regular human being with a house and things to take care of. And so he preached for us last Sunday. He's preaching today. He will preach next Sunday. And what a blessing it has been for us just to watch his growth in so many different ways. In addition, he plays the guitar for us to help lead us in worship, and that has been an incredible blessing. So please pray for Gary, pray for Lori, pray for all of our students who are finishing their courses of study for this semester. What a privilege it is for us to be able to use the minds that God has given us to be able to learn things to help make the world a better place. As we begin, I want to read from Psalm 116. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. And then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me. The Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the unwary. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return to your rest, my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. Let's pray. Oh Lord, those words are so true. You have been so good to us. Even in times of distress and sorrow, when we called out to you, Lord, you brought us through. You showed us the way through. You carried us through in some instances. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and for your grace. I pray, Lord, that as we take a deep breath now, and another, Holy Spirit, come. Guide our thinking. Help us to focus now on you and on your goodness, on your call, on our lives. We come ready to worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come your glory, God, is worthy. to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
Hey, friends. Well, have you ever been like when you're writing with a pencil or maybe you're doing your homework and you make a mistake and so you have to erase it? So I'm just going to make a mark here. So I have my words there. And so I'm going to use this eraser to erase it. Well, you ever notice that sometimes when you erase something, you can kind of still see that it was there? Like the remnants of it are still there. Well, that's kind of how we can be when we forgive others. Sometimes when people do something wrong against us, they might hurt us, they might say an unkind word. Sometimes when we say we forgive them, we still have that little bit of smudge there, and that we can still maybe hold part of that against them. Well, you know, in the Bible, when the Bible talks about God forgiving us, it means He doesn't hold our sins against us. It's like if I wrote on the whiteboard. And when you write on a whiteboard and you erase it, guess what? You can't tell that it was there. And so that's how God handles our sins. God has forgiven us so completely. The Bible says that He makes us whiter than snow, and He does not hold our sins against us. I want you guys to think back to the Easter story. Do you guys remember what Peter did on the night Jesus was arrested? Well, Peter did several things, but one of the things that Peter did was Peter denied knowing Jesus 3 times. Now, that doesn't sound like Peter being a very good friend, saying he didn't know Jesus. Not just once, but 3 times. But you know what happened after Jesus rose again? Jesus forgave Peter, and He actually commissioned Peter to go and spread the gospel and to still be part of Jesus's team. He asked Peter 3 times, "Peter, do you love me?" Essentially saying, "Hey, I want you to go do this. I forgive what you have done to me in the past, and I'm not going to hold that against you, but you are going to go ahead and take care of the people that are going to hear about me." And so God's forgiveness, you know, we do things that are wrong all the time. I do things every day that are not pleasing or honoring to God. Because remember, sin is anything that we think, say, or do that does not please God. Well, we can do that a lot, but God doesn't hold our sins against us. The Bible says that when we seek forgiveness, God forgives us. When we confess our sins to Him, God is faithful to forgive us of all our sins. And it's not this smudged version of forgiveness. It's this whiteboard version where God doesn't see our sins anymore. Well, friends, let's pray and let's thank God for His forgiveness. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your complete forgiveness, that when we believe in You, You forgive us of all of our sins. You make us whiter than snow. Lord, we just thank You for Jesus dying on the cross to forgive us of our sins and coming to life so that we can have resurrection life with You. Lord, help us to extend this forgiveness to other people. As You have forgiven us, help us to forgive others, Lord. Oh, Lord, we ask Your blessing over everyone worshiping with us today. We love You. We thank You. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. All right, friends, remember, friends, that you are forgiven in Christ. And help and remember to share that forgiveness with those around you. Hope you have a great week. We'll see you next time.
I've been waiting to tell you something. It started with the fishermen. He taught them a new way of life. He turned everything upside down to make it right side up.
Forgive 7 times? Try 70 times 7, he said. Just be nice? No. Give it all over, whatever is asked of you.
Reach over the tracks. Yeah, go to that part of town. Cling to the eternal and shake off the chains of this earth.
Sin messed everything up, the whole world, but He made it right.
Our Father, who is in heaven, holy and honored is your name. Your kingdom, it's come.
I'm pledging my life to bring it closer and closer, to show the power of your divine love, to declare deliverance from death and sin.
To all people, to each race in every language.
Making disciples of all nations, I'll own my responsibility. Go all in and make it real in my corner of the world.
The authority Jesus has already been given.
The kingdom that will come on earth as it is in heaven.
An everlasting dominion that will never pass.
Because he beat death.
Coming as the King of the Jews and finishing it all as the King of the world. His throne and authority are sovereign.
You heard right. Forgiveness without boundaries. Hope in all circumstances. And a peace that passes understanding.
Because death is conquered, eternal life is established.
That's why we keep going. Why I keep telling.
The Alpha and the Omega.
The beginning and the end.
The root.
The offspring.
The bright morning star.
Baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
From street to street.
Nation to nation.
He is the King. Power and glory belong to Him.
His kingdom will have no end.
There's room for you and room for me.
Room for everyone who calls on the name of the King.
And his name is Jesus, the name above all names.
The first and last.
The one and only.
And he loves you.
And he loves you.
He loves you.
And he loves you.
And that is what I've been wanting to tell you.
Peace be with you. Those were some of the parting words that Jesus left to his disciples before he ascended into heaven. Which brings me to a question. Have you ever thought about what it means to leave a legacy? Now, a legacy is an example of what you leave behind, the parting words of your life. And alternatively, have you ever thought about what some would write about your life in an obituary? What might they say about an example of your life that you would pass on to others in concise words? Now, I'm not speaking about the inheritance of money. Not at all. Instead, an example of what you loved and you lived while on the earth. And what would you say, or what would others say about yourself? However, we are not the main subject or character of today's message. Jesus is. Jesus is. Now, after the death and the resurrection of Jesus, we are reading from the gospel passages. And in essence, Jesus is writing his legacy to pass down to his disciples, to go and tell others. His words are powerful, and Jesus tells them to go and to be an example to others of the things that he had taught them. Well, not just to the disciples gathered in that room, but to the church, to you and me, and, as Matthew says, all the nations. So therefore, for our time together, I will focus on the Great Commission. I will be reading mainly from the Gospels of Matthew chapter 28 and John chapter 20. You see, the message and the parting words of Jesus' post-resurrection commission arrive in all four Gospel recordings of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And the wording of each writer is just a bit different. But the message's spirit remains the same. It is time for me, Jesus, to go. Now, before I leave, I'm telling you, it is your time to go. And to say to the world that you are a saved and a sent people. And we see this as a recurring theme in the New Testament. Now, imagine yourself as one of Jesus's as one of Jesus' disciples, seeing Jesus after his resurrection. People had just witnessed Jesus murdered on the cross. And as I stated last week in my sermon, they were powerless to do anything about that circumstance. Now, they as the disciples, they were being chased down. They were being hunted, and they were hiding, and they were wondering, oh, what's next? Now, in addition, in the next scene, we see the disciples hiding in this room with the doors locked, and all of a sudden, Jesus appears. He's standing there, and he says, peace be with you. Now, imagine the shock and the confusion. And some of the disciples believed, and they were so joyful to see their risen Lord, their friend. But yet others were troubled, and they were frightened at seeing the Lord as if he were a ghost, back from the dead. Now, I gotta wonder, how would I react to this? And how would you react? Something to think about. But there are questions that arise, and today I will travel to that place in time, and I'm going to attempt to unpack some of the questions we might ask, how this applies to today's culture. Questions like, what is the legacy of Jesus? Questions like, who does Jesus want to send? And who is Jesus charging with the assignment of training and teaching? Just the original apostles was the first thing that came to my mind. Or what does this training and teaching consist of? Does it apply to the church? Does it apply to every Christian? There are a lot of questions that arise, questions to think about. But before we even dive into this, I want to take this time to pray together so that Christ's Spirit will speak to our hearts. So why don't you join with me in prayer? Almighty Father, we ask you that you reveal to us this day the deep things of your word. We give thanks to you for sending your son Jesus to teach the first disciples so that we can in turn ask your Spirit to open our minds and hearts so that we can understand the spiritual truth fulfilled through the scriptures. Holy Spirit, be our teacher and our guide. Teach us and remind us of everything Jesus said to his disciples. Restore us and make us new. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, let's take this time to read from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verse 21. Now, and as we read from the Gospel of John, Jesus appears to his disciples, and it was a few days after the crucifixion. The disciples were huddled together with the doors locked. They were in fear, hunted down. So what does Jesus say? He says, peace be with you. Showing them his hands and his side. It's like he was saying, hey, everybody, remember me? Here I am. I did what I said I was going to do. Welcome me back. Welcome me back. And again, Jesus says, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And with that, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, then they are also forgiven. But if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now, as we return to some of the questions that I had brought up, I want to first look at the first question. What is the way of life that Jesus is referring to, and to who is Jesus charging with the assignment of training? If we go back to Matthew's Gospel, to the Sermon of the Mount in chapter 5, we could summarize what Jesus taught the disciples that is found in the Beatitudes. Now, in the Beatitudes, Jesus provides this concise summary typically found in the ideal follower of Christ and the blessings received as the first taste of eternal life. In essence, if you belong to God, then you are the light of the world, a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. Now let's go to another post-resurrection event in a gospel book found in Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. Now listen to these words taken from Matthew. And I'm reading from the NIV Bible. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Thanks be to God. What is it that we see here? Do we see options? No, there are no options. And often churches, and I know this from previous experience, that sit around a table and they decide whether to go on a short mission trip or to send or support missionaries or intentionally pray or just give money. In essence, they try to decide which to choose. Now, what I say is that Jesus, nor does the New Testament, provide options when it comes to following Christ's commission. Instead, we are to do all three. In Christ, we are a saved people that go, send, and pray. And that is what I love about Upper Path Valley Presbyterian Church. We do all three. Although maybe it's been a little bit difficult in this previous year or so. But the support is there. How important is that? I hope that we all know what it means to be a saved and sent people. It is not about, can we go? It's not about, can we go? Alternatively, should we go? But however will we go? Now, also in Matthew's gospel, in 24:14, he says this, "And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all the nations. And then the end will come." So here we see in this particular verse a command word, will. The gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world. And from this verse, we see that there is no option. You will. Now, from the verse, we could also ask what the question to all nations means. Well, as of 2021, there are 195 countries in the world today. And according to the Joshua Project, the people groups segment gets just a bit messy. And the people group, if I can explain just a short bit of it, it's about language. According to these categories, many deciding factors determine how a people group become identified and what groups remain unengaged in the gospel? And there are different answers. If you go to a different website, they will give you different answers. But for our purposes now, we will go with from the Joshua Project. There's an estimated 24,000 people groups in the world. And furthermore, of which about 8,000 of these groups remained untouched by the good news of the gospel. That is a lot of people. Therefore, here is the tension of God's word that all nations will hear and will testify to the promise and the mission of God. And this is what Matthew's gospel says. But Jesus is calling us, saying to us, get on board now. Now is the time to go. And Jesus is inviting us into God's story of mission through his sovereignty. And what Christ accomplished on the cross is that he brings life into death. And he calls those who are far off near to him. So what is the legacy of Jesus in his way of life? Well, the gift of Jesus is that he taught the offer of salvation to everyone who believes while teaching us the message of reconciliation. We need a lot of reconciliation in these days. Now, I want you to hear these words from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17 through 20. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation, he and she. The old has gone, the new has come. And all this from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Jesus Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are, therefore, Christ's ambassadors. We are his ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. It is not because of inviting people to church that fulfills the commission of Christ. It is the message that we share as messengers that meets the call as his disciples. We need to get that clear in our heads. Who does Jesus want to send? Well, Jesus wants to send all of us. If we are believers in Christ, then we are his ambassadors. We were reconciled to God and made messengers of reconciliation. And I hope that for this purpose of this message is that we can see that Christ saved us. And as a people sent as disciples to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. So who is Jesus charging with the assignment of training? As Christ followers and disciples of him, Jesus expects us to learn from each other and then teach, training those who do not know about the gift of free salvation. I find it interesting, I heard this week, that someone never heard of the Great Commission. They never heard of it. The church that they grew up in never taught about its teaching. I find that hard to believe. But this brings me to a point that as disciples of Christ, we do not need to go abroad to find people never hearing about Christ's commission to go and spread the good news of the gospel. We can see them next door and maybe in our own families. The original apostles were to go and teach others. And from these original apostles, they taught others who became disciples, spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, you know, if you do not know me, but yet those who do know me know that I love music. I love it a lot. And music has this propensity to spread the gospel. This week I heard a gospel message through a song titled The Commission. And for me, the music is another avenue to proclaim the gospel message. Now, Martin Luther once said that music in the church functions as the living voice of the gospel, praising God and proclaiming his word to the world. Now, whether revealed in word or in tone, the gospel message must be the exact words spoken with faithfulness and heard with trusting and repentant hearts. And therefore, we take care in selecting music not as a form of entertainment, but one that proclaims the gospel through well-made music. In the increasing diversity of music available for bringing people into the presence of God, no single universal style is adequate enough. So, in conclusion for this message, I leave you with these words from the song titled The Commission. And they go like this. See my hands and look at my feet. It is okay if it is hard to believe. I have faith that you will do greater things. It is my time to go. But before I leave, go tell the world about me. I was dead, but now I live. I've got to go now for a little while, but goodbye is not the end. Don't forget the things I've taught you. There's much to do here before you leave, so go tell the world about me. Before I close, hear these words taken from Revelation chapter 5, verses 9 through 12. And they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on earth. Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice they sang, Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Church, as Jesus would say, peace be with you. It is time to go, telling the world that Jesus is alive. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be upon you this day, tomorrow, and forevermore. Amen.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. My life, I will trust in you.
Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, the name of the Lord is to be praised. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege we have had to worship together. Thank you for the call that you have on our lives to go and to tell. Oh, Lord, open our eyes to see where you are sending us. Open our hearts to hear your voice speaking to us. Open our lips to say the words that you want us to say. Ready our feet so that we may go where you are calling us to go. Open our hands that we may reach those that you are calling us to reach. We know for sure that we are not called just to sit and do nothing for you. We know that we are called to go. And what a privilege it is. Oh Lord, may your light shine on the path before us. And may your light shine from the Spirit within us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, may the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen.
You healed a broken hearted. You set the captive free. You lift the heavy burden.
You do.
possible.